panel with the governor at the University of Denver a couple of weeks ago, and I said, we have the speaker, Bob Manta. And the governor interrupted me. He was the moderator of the panel, but he just came in and started describing Bob Manta.
I'm sort of glad that he's not here.
You're sort of glad he's not here? Okay. I won't pass that on to him, I guess. That's part of the Central American West is very careful on discrete communications, and we'll start with that. So welcome to the event. I need to tell you about a very nice upcoming event, the Center of the American West series, Modern Indian Identity, which is made possible by Liz and Tony Moores, has an important upcoming event on October 26th. The accomplished Navajo or Diné photographer Will Wilson will be in town, and he'll be giving a presentation on what he calls the critical indigenous exchange, which refers to the impressive and thought-provoking work that Will Wilson has undertaken using the techniques of the influential photographer Edward Curtis to build a contemporary version of Native North America. So Curtis, the guy who has the Indian people who look as if they are fading into the past, and now an Indian person has taken possession of that technique. So that's Monday, October 26th, 6:30 p.m. in Hale 270 for a remarkable artist and a very fine speaker. Tonight is the launching event for the Center of the American West's new humor initiative, an undertaking made possible by Bill and Jane Reynolds. There was an interesting article on the front page of the Daily Camera today about this event, and so I must begin tonight by following up on the assertion made and the promise given in that article. It is my conviction that we are experiencing a shortfall of humor in public conversation, and while I empathize, that was not quoted in the paper, but I do empathize with the dilemma of public figures who, if they unleash their senses of humor, may well make themselves vulnerable to accusations that they have trivialized serious topics. While I feel that empathy, I also feel certain that licensing public figures to possess and openly exercise senses of humor is in the interest of democratic self-government. In point of fact, I think it will actually, this might be our only hope. There's a little bit of a disagreement with me and the guest speaker on that, but he's not in the least hostile to humor. He just wants me to moderate my expectations for what humor can do. So, are there, this is a question I must ask now, are there candidates for elected office in attendance? Are there concurrent holders of elected office present? I have quite a bit of influence in this town when you get down there. I am really quite a force. Well, at the end of this evening's program, they may be coming a little bit late. They're probably at a fundraiser right now, so they'll be here. At the end of the program, tell any candidates for office who would like to receive a document certifying that they are endowed with senses of humor, they should come up to the front of the room. We have a team of students affiliated with the center who will serve as a screening team. And they will, Adrian, where are you? You should raise your hands. Okay, there they are. There's the screening team. That's our very high quality team back there. And they will ask the applicants what they found funniest in the evening presentation, which you'll soon see is not going to be an easy question to answer to figure out which thing you'd pick and why they found that thing the funniest. Then, the successful candidates will be handed on to Mr. Mankoff and me, and we have really beautiful certificates that we are ready to sign. On these documents, these nice documents, it says, by attending and responding enthusiastically to the Fool for a Day launching event for the Center of the American West, your name goes here, has demonstrated that she or he possesses a healthy sense of humor, a quality that is as valuable in proportion to its rarity in American public life in 2015. If we are not overwhelmed by applicants, which kind of seems the way we're going right now, this is important. So this, we will have some applicants probably by this. We are also inviting ardent proponents and ardent opponents of ballot initiatives 300 and 301 to apply for these certificates as well as people with very strong feelings, and the students will have to certify that those are very strong. Oh, Katie, you need to be on the committee too. Okay, we just picked up another screen. That's really good. Okay, so anyway, we were also accepting applications for these certificates from people with extremely strong feelings about the right sizing of Folsom Avenue. Okay, now to the main event. We are fortunate beyond measure to launch the Center's Humor Initiative with a presentation by Bob Mankoff, who has been since 1997 the cartoon editor of the New Yorker magazine. Hey. And I think we'll have, okay, Mr. Mankoff, I think this next sentence has to have a round of applause too. Mr. Mankoff is a gifted cartoonist himself, and he is the author of a number of books, including the recent How About Never? Is Never Good For You? My Life in Cartoons. And that needs another round of applause. Now, tonight, building on my own distinctive track record as the official fool of Yale University, Harvard University, and the University of Colorado, we are tonight inaugurating two exciting new customs. We are designating Bob Mankoff as the first ever recipient of the Center of the American West Fool for a Day Award. And we are also performing a first-time ever ceremony. We are asking Mr. Mankoff to be the first person to hold and be photographed with the Humor Initiative Welded Pickle. And his name will be the first to be inscribed on this handsome trophy. But it'll be inscribed on its face. As to why we are celebrating this occasion with the ceremonial pickle, well, that is a complicated story. You probably guessed that. But it hinges on the fact that becoming connoisseurs of dill pickles proved to be a way of expressing our individual and collective fondness for Jack Thompson, board member emeritus of the Center. And there is also the fact that the word pickle is inherently funny, as in to be in a pickle or to try to get out of a pickle. And a pickle is also pretty silly in shape. So, Ben, would you join me?
I think I'm just going to take a selfie with it.
Well, I think
Okay,
and now actually we need a little bit more of a photo op.
Okay.
So this is.
There you go.
I haven't quite finished. I'm almost finished. Okay. That's really close. So now we have awarded Bob Mankoff the ceremonial pickle, and I think one really, really hard to wrap
it up. I was sort of hoping for a Nobel, but this is going to happen.
And you were the first. And now, out of the recognition that he will himself, in a very memorable way, soon tell you about his background. I am not going to recite his resume. Instead, I'm just going to go sit down and I'm going to have a wonderful evening in which I will episodically laugh until I cannot breathe. So,
okay. Let me give you back the pickle. Okay, you know, you guys are actually, I mean, I'm often here with a number of audiences and you guys are actually a pretty good looking audience. I'm going to take a selfie. I don't know, maybe it's the air, maybe it's the pot. I don't know, but you're really a nice looking artist. So, yeah, I'm really happy to be
keep
here.
Keep that close to your...
What's that?
Keep that as close to your mouth as you can.
Not going to do that. See, Patty wants to control everything.
I want the people.
Part of being funny. Part of being funny is not obeying what people tell you to do. See, like that. Like that's immediately worrisome and raises the tension. Okay, so let's get on with this if we can. Now, okay, it's the center. Oh, so it's the Center of the American West. Now. We're going to have something that's funny, so it really has to be a little bit off-center. You know what I'm saying? It really can't be completely regular and be funny. So I'm going to do sort of a discursive, we'll use the term, talk about the history of humor and humor and history. And I'm going to start with me. My history. Now the book, this book is available now. It's in paperback. If you buy the book, or have the book, or have stolen the book, I'm going to sign like that, I'll do a little drawing for you. I think that's nice. And you know, let's face it, I am the cartoon editor of the New Yorker. If I put a drawing in there, it might be a little bit more valuable. Over time, it might increase it, so I would like it back. Now, the truth is, I know not all of you are going to read this book, so here's a whole preview of Kofi. Okay, look, I saved you $22. So, okay, so this is the book, and the book actually has quite a bit of writing in it, and, you know, about me and my background. And that first chapter is called, I'm Not Arguing, I'm Jewish. And believe me, it's been a little bit hard for me to be out here in Colorado. I mean, there's the altitude, the acclimation, and the fact that people are so nice. You know what I'm saying? I'm coming from New York, so it's like, it's disturbing. I mean, it's almost worse than Canadians. So, and actually, this comes about, that title, really, because I've been married 3 times, and it keeps getting better and better. First one was a training marriage. And the second one I learned, but not enough. There's a great cartoon in the New Yorker in which a guy is asking his wife, you know, she's in the kitchen, is there anything else I can do for you wrong? Anyway, my wife, Corey Scott Woody, is not Jewish, and so she's a WASP. And I thought we were having this completely normal conversation, and she said, why are you arguing? And I said, I'm not arguing, I'm Jewish. but arguing and being Jewish, actually, the background to it, well, I'm not that Jewish. And remember, if you need anything, I'm available 24/6. But a lot of the book is my background, you know, growing it up. And so this is a cartoon in New York, it's too Jewish. And, you know, you'll understand that so much in Colorado. But when I was growing up, and this probably relates to the immigrant experience now, you know, somewhat. And there's this, you know, it's like, well, what should you be? Should you be authentic to your identity? Should you assimilate? Well, when I was growing up, there was no question. In the 50s, you assimilated. I grew up in New York, I wanted to play for the New York Yankees, I wanted to be Mickey Mantle, and my mother spoke Yiddish. And it's interesting, here's a cartoon going back to 1929, showing this sort of conflict, immigrant conflict. It says, in memory of our beloved father, Isidore Cohen, see, and all the sons have changed their names. So the idea when I was growing up was it's good to be Jewish. It's good to have what's called a Yiddish kop, which means a Jewish head. But the idea was, think Yiddish, but dress British. But now it's interesting in that in terms of comedy. Now, it was a study in 1980. It's not as true as it was, but in 1980, 80% of the people in professional comedy in the United States were Jewish. Now, obviously, a lot has changed in terms of what's out front and all the people performing. But behind the scenes of the Jon Stewart show and these various shows, there's a very, very great proportion. And this is an interesting...
I'll tell you what's up. I'm a Jew.
Excuse me?
I'm a Jew. I finished converting 2 days ago.
Oh, well. Welcome aboard.
Hey, were you just at the health club?
Oh, yeah. No, we must have just missed you.
Ah, well, I didn't do much. I just sat in the sauna. You know, it was more like a Jewish workout.
Oh, the guy's Jewish 2 days. He's already making Jewish jokes.
That which reminds me, did you hear the one about the rabbi and the farmer's daughter?
Huh? So that's it. So the question a little bit, and I delve in the book in terms of the history of humor in general, is really, so how did the people of the book, the Jews, the Old Testament, which... Now, the Old Testament is not funny. I mean, There's laughter like 29 times in it, and when God laughs, you're toast. It's not good. It is not a good thing. So it's an interesting question. I delve into the book. And, I mean, this is like a very, very superficial sort of survey of it, but it's also true. The book there is Talmud. Now, the Talmud tries to explain the craziness of the Bible. It questions it. It argues. So that's sort of what's unique, I think, frankly, about the Jewish people through the Talmud, is that they're essentially arguing with the Bible. They're trying to say, this doesn't make sense, and that. And then, you know, the rabbis and the rebbes, they want to make the Bible turn out okay, you know, so they keep commenting and commenting and commenting. And that's called Pilpul, which is this intense study of the Bible and the commentary, and the commentaries on the commentary. Well, when you do something like that, anything you do seriously and intensely long enough, eventually you becomes parody. So here's these yeshiva boys, okay? And here's an actual type of discussion which shows how it sort of borders and becomes ludicrous, okay? I skipped the wrong slide, but so there's the Talmud. So this is a joke about, is there a section at the bottom for comments? Well, all the Talmud is comments. Comments on comments. And when you look at the logic, this is the logic. Two men go down a chimney, one comes out with a clean face, the other with a dirty face. Which one washes his face? The dirty one. Wrong, the clean one. The one with the clean face looks at the dirty one and thinks his face is dirty and vice versa. No, each one washes his face when the man with the dirty face sees the man with the clean one. What he also does, incorrect. How can two men go down a chimney and one come up with a dirty face? So this type of sort of logic chopping, this type of, you know, intense logic, which eventually sort of turns back on itself, is part, I think, of sort of the background, the Jewish sort of cognitive background. Now, in 1905, Sigmund Freud writes a book, Jokes and Their Relation to the Unconscious. This is a very dense book about psychology, the unconscious, the reasons for jokes, aggression, sexuality, all that. But there are a lot of jokes in it. Okay? And the jokes have a very distinct quality, and they have a logical quality to it, or a sort of logic turned on itself. So one of the tropes, or one of the actual situations in late 19th century Europe in the Jewish community is various types. And one of the types is the schnorrer, or the schnorrer, which is called. Now, a schnorrer is sort of like a beggar, except he's not really a beggar, because in the Jewish religion, you're obligated to give to people who don't have it. So it's your obligation. So this means the schnorrer feels very entitled to things. And many of the jokes arise around this. So the rich man in Vienna gives the schnorrer some money because the schnorrer says, I'm not feeling well. And then the rich man goes to the fanciest spa. The spa, the rich man goes to in Vienna and he sees the schnorrer there. He says, what are you doing here? I gave you some money and you're spending it all here? And the schnorrer says, look, when it comes to my health, money's no object. The rich man, the schnorrer, says, I'm hungry. Could you give me a little something to eat? And so the rich man does. And then he finds him eating whatever the Viennese dish was, some fancy salmon dish, you know, in the best restaurant. He says, what are you doing? I gave you a little money. You said you're starving. You're eating salmon, this fancy salmon. And the schnorrer says, now look, if when I don't have money, I can't eat salmon. And when I do have money, I can't eat salmon. When can I eat salmon? So temporarily using logic, do you know what I mean, to do it. And also during the 19th century, there's the matchmaker. Many jokes about the matchmaker. The matchmaker brings the bride to the groom. So the matchmaker brings his bride to the groom, and the groom comes over and he says to the matchmaker, what did you pay me? She's blind in one eye, she stammers, she has a limp. And the matchmaker says, you don't have to whisper, she's deaf too. So this is the background. So the background, I could go on about Eastern Europe in the background. My own experience is that, of course, I'm growing up in the 50s, And my mother speaks Yiddish and curses me in Yiddish, and that's a whole other thing because the curses themselves are funny. You know, first of all, Yiddish is funny. You know, shmegegi, lundek. So my mother would call me, let's say, a kleine hint, a little dog, a gross affair, a big horse, and she would also call me a nervous and cholera. Now, nervous and cholera, so nervous so you can understand what that means. Cholera is cholera, a plague. But essentially, my mother was calling me a nervous plague, which I was. But the other part of my experience with growing up is that I grew up in the 50s, we used to go to the Catskills. The Catskills was the Borscht Belt. We're all the comedians, you know, would be Jerry Lewis, Rodney Dangerfield, Buddy Hackett, Jackie Mason, Alan King. And of course, though, just like that Tombstone, those weren't their names, right? Because it was actually very important in the 50s and 60s that even though you're like Jack Benny and George Burns, people did not, let's say, if you were Jewish, you knew they were Jewish. But they weren't identified, so it was important, actually, not to be too ethnic. But there, I sort of got marinated in the comedy of stand-up. So this is Rodney Dangerfield.
I'll tell you more right now. Last week, I was a rough shape, you know? Yeah. Now, last week, I told my wife, need a home improvement loan. She gave me $1,000 to move out. I'll tell you, my wife, there's always something, you know? Well, the other day, I called her up and said to her, honey, I've been thinking about the last time we had sex. I'm getting excited. She said, who is this? Well, the first time I called her up, she told me, come on over, there's nobody home. I went over, there was nobody home.
So growing up, so this is part of the history of humor in the United States. And my sort of superficial comment is, frankly, Jews are to American humor what blacks are to American basketball. Honestly. So like Henny Younger, here's some one-liners, pushing 50 isn't a problem, it's pulling 49. The children are just pretending substitutes for people who can't have pets. I'm a citizen of the world, but I'm based in Germany. You know, I don't know what I'd like to do without it, but I sure like to find out. Now, that's not Henny Younger, these are all my cartoons. So that what I'm drawing here is the parallel. I'm saying the jokes that I ended up doing have the rhythm. This rhythm that growing up, and it was interesting growing up, like I said, I wanted to be Mickey Mantle. The last thing I wanted, I wish I had learned Yiddish, actually, or at least not been repelled by it. Okay, so that's the this cartoon, No Thursdays Out, How the Never's Never Get to You, which the book is, you know, the title. That's my sort of best known cartoon. I founded the Cartoon Bank, and cartoonists make a good deal of money on reprints. So this is the cartoon. Every time it gets reprinted in a textbook or a print or a t-shirt or whatever, get money for it. That cartoon put my daughter through college. And that's why she wears the t-shirt. And it's become sort of a catchphrase. When in 2008, Nancy Pelosi, when they were Republicans, said, and they said to the president, how about never? Does it never work for you? Now, it's also in the Yellow Book of Quotations. See that? Now, you can see how old I am now. Now, here are my three jokes that I created on becoming 70. So the first joke is, you know, I'm 70. The good news is, it could be worse. The bad news is, it will be. I'm 70. The good news is, 70 is the new 50. The bad news is dead is not the new alive. You know, when you're 70 and you're a guy and you wake up, you're stiff all over except where you want to be. Anyway, next to that other famous humorist now say time. Okay, so the t-shirt, now the deal is also you get the copyright for the cartoon, but not necessarily the phrase. Now I have the copyright for the phrase, you have to go through lawyers and stuff. So you get it on t-shirts, I don't get any money for that. And you can get it on a thong. So I can't get any money for that, they just want to give me free thongs. Okay, so I've done a lot of cartoons, and now I founded the Cartoon Bank, and I was able to do that because The New Yorker, since its inception in 1925, every single cartoon that was ever created, of course, it had a scrapbook, but more importantly, it essentially keyworded all those cartoons by putting them in different volumes. So me, Charles Adam, Peter Arnold, all the cartoons were there when I created the Cartoon Bank in the mid-90s, in back in 97 for the New Yorker. I just used optical character recognition. I was able to essentially scan all of it, and then when you're dead, they put that on that. People ask me, well, how do you think of ideas for cartoons? And I say, well, I think of them. Okay, I'm going to show you a little bit how simple, the simplest possible ideas. Simplest possible ideas. And this will even go a little bit to my friend Pete McGraw, who is at the University of Colorado, and he has the theory that to be funny, things have to be right and wrong at the same time. Now, I think Peter's right. Right isn't funny. Okay? So wrong makes it a little funny. Not much. Not really a joke, but wrong is funnier than right. There's no question about that. But to make it funny, you have to complete something. You have to have an idea. Okay, so now it's funny. Okay, so that's right, okay, because the girl carries the two word words.
That's right.
It's not funny, and that's wrong. It's weird. So already your mind bothers you a little bit, and that's funny. That's right, because lemmings, for the lemmings, drive off the cliff. They don't actually commit suicide, they're just very stupid. That's wrong. And so automatically the wrong is funnier, but there's no idea behind it. It's just funny because it's not what we expect. But it's not what I would call humor, in a sense. It's our reaction to the unexpected, but not real humor. And now it's funny. Now the thing about cartoons at the New Yorker is that on some level they're just a gag. But that cartoon is not about lemmings. See, that's why it gets reprinted in textbooks and that, because, and it can mean many different things. It can be about belief itself and our need for belief, even though the belief is obviously strains credulity. So, you know, especially in the times we're in where there's so much strife between the different religions, and when they're all arguing about who has the best imaginary friend. I mean, honestly. Okay, so how did I become sort of, that's part of the book. I went to the High School of Music and Art, and this was a school on 135th Street and Convent Avenue. It was so cool. I went 58 to 62. I think it was in 59 that we legalized pot. And I went for art. You could go for art or music, and the movie Fame is sort of based on this school, although it conflates it with high school performing arts as well. But a really cool school, which is now named because they thought the name would be catchier to call it LaGuardia High School. But it was very cool that we had a jacket, High School of Music and Art, we had little berets. Okay, so here I am in 1962, and look at this dude. At Edgar Garrett. It's 1962 and he shows up with a class photo with a pipe. He's 18. And look, so the great thing about the internet now is writing his memoir. So what happened to Edgar Garrett? The guy with the pipe. He became the dean of American pipe. If I had only had that focus, I could have been. But no, I got to be in 1962, and then I went to Syracuse University where I majored in hair. So I went. I was a very bad student, and I couldn't be a good student because I didn't go to class. But it was the 60s, and well, the summer of the 60s anyway. And so, but being there was really a transformative experience for me. And really, the transformative experience happened one day, one exam. So I didn't go to class. And because you didn't have to go to class, you know, they didn't take attendance, and there were these huge lecture halls. But so one day, I attended the first sociology class, okay, and then it's fine, but I'm late, and so the room is already filled like it is now. And I come in, and I'm totally hippified, and you can imagine how I run, I take my seat, and everyone's already there. You know, working really hard on their blue books and everything, and so I quickly take one, and then the teacher comes over to me, and, you know, the class is silent, because he looms over me and says, "Who the hell are you?" And I looked up at him, and I said, "You know, I could very well ask you the same question." Probably the most important day because it showed me what humor can be. It showed me the courage, you know, I mean, the courage to not be cowed, the courage to actually put things in perspective in some way. Okay, this was a teacher, and you know, when I grew up, you know, the teachers were always threatened. This is going on, you're permanent. So I said, this is great. I realized this is going on my permanent. And of course, the class burst out in the same laughter just like you did. So it was that the right joke at the right time had enormous power. Power to completely upset the usual dynamics that would normally exist in that situation. And so that was really that. And I was interested in a few topics. I eventually went to graduate school for experimental psychology, and I got all my credits for my PhD. I was on the cusp of my PhD, but it was the world's largest cusp. It just went on forever. I never saw a cusp this long. So I had all my credits, and then I told my parents that my Jewish parents, who self-identified as Jewish because they were Jewish, I wasn't going to be a psychologist, I was going to be a cartoonist, because in some way I had always wanted to be a cartoonist going way back, even when I was at high school music and art. It was something that was there, but it's easy to get sidetracked from the creative life. You know what I mean? In the turbulence of your youth and adolescence and whatever, but in the back of my mind it was there. And that was weird because it was actually in the back of my mind. I had gone to get this degree, and then all of a sudden when I basically flunked out, that's a whole story that I have in the book also. So anyway, I told my mother, you know, she started screaming, and then I told my father. Now, my parents were born in 1907 and 1908. So they thought, first of all, they thought just getting a job in the civil service would be like the world's greatest thing, because they couldn't fire you. You know, my mother used to say, "You don't care what you do. We don't care if you're a garbage man as long as you're the best garbage man." And I said to her, "You know, there are over 12,000 sanitation workers in New York City. That's got to be tough." Be the best garbage man. I don't know if I have the skill set to rise to the top of the garbage heap. That's impossible for me. But they were great people. But my father looked at me really sternly, told him I was going to be a cartoonist, and he said, "You know, they already have people who do that." And I said, "Yeah, but one of them might die." And then I'll just be there. I'll read the obits. I'll be just on top of it. Yeah, the experiments, I think, said how you were with animals, rats and pigeons, doing things you're not allowed to do to them anymore. Basically, we rewarded them on reinforcement schedules. You know, the psychology department is probably still little rats working very hard here. Okay. And what you found out was that if you rewarded an animal all the time, they certainly pressed the bar, but when you stopped rewarding them, they stopped very soon rewarding continuously. However, if they were rewarded intermittently, so first every time, then once every fourth, then on a random schedule, like a gambling schedule, then it would be very persistent behavior. I'll show you the reference to this. Anyways, that's me in 1974. I quit. I started selling, actually, some cartoons in some magazines, not the New Yorker. I get rejected by the New Yorker. Okay. And then... selling to some other magazine that I'm sort of being intermittently reinforced. So, ironically, I'm on the same schedule and being trained to be very persistent in this very unproductive from a remunerative standpoint. Okay. First question I ever saw was the Saturday Review, 74. Faster than a speeding bullet, more powerful than a locomotive, no shorthand.
That shows how long ago this cartoon was.
Okay. This is a cartoon I also saw. Please tell the king I remembered the punch. And all the background is created with a epigraph pen in this stipple style, which I actually developed at the High School of Music and Art, and it was a pain in the ass, and a pain in the real pain in the neck, and a pain in the fist. It was engineer of carpal tunnel syndrome. Anyway, but I kept, between 74 and 77, I literally submitted well over 1,000 cartoons in New York, constantly rejected, while I was selling to other places, little things like that. But then finally, this changed to this. Now, of course, that is not what happened, but that's the only way I felt. You know what I mean? And I hit a lot of different people as well. Great, I can quit. And then 3 years later, I got a contract from the New Yorker. I blurred out the part about the drugs, the women, the money. But the interesting thing about the contract is nowhere in the contract from the New Yorker does it mention the word cartoon. It's all ideas. So there's many different types of things that make us laugh. If you watch America's Funniest Home Videos, it's funny to watch people falling down, I guess, with music. And, you know, the guy saying, watch out for that ball, Johnny, you know. But in other words, we will laugh at those things. There's no real idea behind it. But the idea behind the New Yorker cartoon is there's always some sort of idea. And here's some of the ideas I came up with. I'm sorry, you know, I wasn't listening. Could you repeat what you said since we've been on? Now that's product placement. It's called Hamlet's Suplex. So for New Yorker cartoons, there's always something to get. Now, so this is the beginning of the book. I dedicated it to everyone who's ever done cartoons for the New Yorker and everyone who ever will. And each year, new cartoons come into the magazine. If you look at the New Yorker now, most of the cartoons are being done by people, men and women, a lot more women than ever in their 20s and 30s now. Okay? So I went from being a cartoonist to eventually I became cartoon editor in 1997. So this is the next page of that story. So a couple of things. This is going to be a little clip from the 60 Minutes episode that was on last March about me and the New Yorker cartoons. And December 7th on HBO, there's a film. It's also going to be in theaters in some theaters in New York and LA, San Francisco, called Very Semi-Serious about the New Yorker cartoons. So that's December 7th on HBO. It's a really interesting portrait
not just me, but the whole New York cartoons as an institution. But this gives you a little idea of what goes on Tuesdays. One of the things, when I took over in 97, I had to realize I did need a new generation of cartoonists. So Tuesdays, after New Yorker, is open call, which means anyone can come in and see me.
Hey, how are you? Paul, Robert. Well, I suppose you came in here to show me cartoons.
Every Wednesday, a nervous band of ink-stained wretches gathers at Bob Mackoff's office.
I don't see what you got here.
Hoping against hope to sell him a cartoon. As for what they're paid, no one's talking.
How many have been accepted, I really don't know.
There's the grizzled veteran Sam Gross, who figures he's submitted 30,000 cartoons, give or take.
30,000? Yeah.
Many consider this his masterpiece. A dog at Heaven's Gate asking, is there any chance of getting my testicles back?
How you doing?
Very well.
There's always a little preliminary chit-chat.
How you been?
Alright.
Farley.
Farley Cat specializes in the far out, in both cartoons and facial hair.
So what's going on with that mustache? Are you still entering the contest?
No, I retired from the circuit. This is all like a recreational mustache.
Okay. And then Mackoff speed reads the rough sketches.
This is just too awkward to draw.
Most get rejected. He's seen the idea in one form or another before.
You know, whenever they open your bag at an airport.
Carolina Johnson has an airport security cartoon with a TSA guy saying, you can pack this back up now. Emily Flake has a joke featuring both King Kong and Godzilla.
The two heavy hitters in the monster world.
It's as simple as that.
Maybe it's just a day for facial hair, but Joe Dana seems to be a contender with a Tarzan cartoon.
The apes are saying, we found you and raised you as one of us. So we were just wondering, at what point did you learn to shave?
Research this. No iteration of Tarzan in literature, comic books, or movies in which he has facial hair. It makes no sense.
Right.
Here's some of the stuff.
This is just stage one, thinning out the candidates to take to the magazine's editor.
That's a little bit too straightforward.
He's largely non-committal, pleasant but blunt.
Don't be right in our magazine.
When a drawing simply isn't good enough.
We're not that impressed. Okay, Ned? It doesn't have enough charm.
So that's sort of what goes on every Tuesday, although it's very, very, very condensed. I do see, that's a very sort of condensed part of it. So anybody can make an appointment to see me when new cartoonists come in, especially now what my main emphasis now is less on my cartoons, but mentoring a whole new generation of people. And I mentor them partly by example and partly by advice. So when they ask me, how many cartoons should I do every week? I say 10. And if they say, well, why 10? I said, because 9 out of 10 things in life don't work out. And that's the most important lesson they can learn. To do a lot of work, to not get in love with. The difference between an amateur and a professional is an amateur really likes their work. So there I am, and so that's part of it, but lots of stuff is coming in electronically, which I don't always print it all out. I can select, use on the PDF and stuff, but 1,000 cartoons coming in. So, look, I'm not smiling. And it's not because the cartoons are bad. It's because evaluating something is not the same as enjoying it. My job is not to be entertained. My job is to decide partly what's going to entertain you. That has to be done with a completely different mindset than you. So it's a mediated experience. Now, you laughed at the cartoons, and I showed you because you thought they're funny. On the other hand, if I gave you all the cartoons that you've seen today and I said, rate them, now it would be a very different experience. You'd understand, you'd make decisions, but you wouldn't be laughing at them anymore. You'd make decisions based on your projection of your own mental processes, so it's a different type of experience. So this is interesting. This is William Hogarth, the laughing audience. So everybody's laughing except that guy, because he's the critic. He's the one evaluating.
okay? So I have to watch out that I don't become and that's actually quite difficult, because as you, it's the paradox of choice. As you, whatever, if you have any job which involves many, many decisions of things that are actually pretty good, you actually start to have to make decisions in which you decide these things are not good. And that's, so I have to factor that in. So it's not, and I'm not thinking when I'm picking the cartoons just what I like. Sometimes I'm thinking, well, I don't actually like this cartoon that much, but I think it's an interesting cartoon or other people might like it. Now, they need a sense of direction, I need a sense of humor, right? But now I want to do a little history stuff. We've talked a lot, this is the humor issue, about sense of humor, right? Well, you want to know, it's a relatively recent concept, the idea of a sense of humor. Before that, it comes about after, in the late 19th century, and before that, it's actually thought of as what we think of as humor and everything is more a sense of ridicule, or even a sense of the ridiculous, and it's not very nice. When we think of humor, we think of it in a broad way as humor as being to laugh at ourselves, right? Being self-reflective. But that's only one part of humor. Most of the stuff you can watch when people find funny is laughing at somebody else. You know, people say it's good to laugh at yourself. It is. Have you ever seen anyone laugh at themselves heartily? I mean, have you ever seen someone really bust their gut laughing at themselves? Never happened. It's sort of like, yeah, you know what I mean? So when you look at the history of humor, Plato, a mixture of pleasure and pain that lies in the malice of amusement. Aristotle, comedy is an imitation of people who are worse than the average. The ludicrous is a species of the ugly, which causes no pain or destruction. Well, there's an element of truth in all this. When you're watching America's Funniest Home Videos or pranks or whatever, you know, you're actually, you know what you're laughing at. And of course Hobbes, which is the superiority theorist, the sudden glory arising from some conception of eminency in ourselves with comparison with others. So now we're seeing part of also what humor is. When you're laughing at someone, they're down, so you're up. So for them it was all sort of the three suitors. Okay, so also going back to the Greeks, so tragedy was about people better than us, and comedy was about people worse. Art elevates, and humor The truth is, humor cannot elevate. You know, I once taught a class in editorial cartoons from a very nice Pakistani youngster, and he said, how come there are no cartoons praising government? You can't have a cartoon praising government. You can't have a cartoon praising anything. You have cartoons that do that, but they're not funny. Okay, when you look at the Greek word for comedy, komos, which meant revel, and it comes out of fertility rites of drinking and sex, you know, and, you know, and now there's old Greek comedy, which is actually pretty sophisticated, but also quite obscene. So this is the background. It's the background about a lot of humor. It's about what's funny, but which is aggressive and often licentious. And if you go to a comedy club, you're going to see the same thing today. Okay, so the Roman Empire, you actually have comedy, you have sort of sitcom, and following the Greeks, you have the rise of Christianity, and you have the decline of humor. Okay, same for the guy. Laughter often gives birth to foul discourse, and foul discourse actions still more foul. Often the words and laughter proceed rarely in an insult, and from rarely an insult, blows and wounds, and from blows and wounds, slaughter and murder. Church, not a big fan of that. Okay, this is advice to his son, Lord Chesterfield. Frequent and loud laughter is the characteristic of folly and ill manners. How low and unbecoming than laughter is not to mention the disagreeable noise that it makes, and the shocking distortion of the face that I had never laughed at. Now, we think this is ludicrous, but this is part of the history of how people looked at laughter, because laughter itself was a complete loss of control, okay? You know, when you look at, here's a book from 1875, showing these are the distortions of the human face that laughter caused, and this guy, George Vassy, said, you know, we should eliminate laughter entirely if we stop tickling children. And then we teach them to laugh, and often that leads to death. So the reason I'm showing you all this, as I said, is to show you some of the history of the actual attitude and to show you how much it's flipped and how, to some extent, we are still missing a truth that exists here. That there, look, humor can be used as a tool for good or evil. I've chosen evil. But your choice can be different. Actually, there's all different types of humor. That's my point here. There's benign humor, there's affiliative humor, there's humor that supports people, there's humor that tears people down. From the discussion that I had with Patty about the humor initiative, my point is, humor is part, is a universal part of human nature, and human nature is complicated. So everything about human nature can be used in many ways. Now, it wasn't like this was the only attitude, or that people realized there's more than this, that there's something important about humor, you know, so when Lord Chatterjee's ridicule is a test of truth, it's almost like a John Stewart statement, like it's a bullshit detector, right? But what was really valued in the 17th and 18th century in England, although there were many contradictory attitudes, was cleverness and repartee. So, okay, upon my soul, Wilkes, I don't know whether you'll die upon the gallows or of syphilis. That will depend, my lord, on whether I embrace your principles or your sins. So this type of stuff was certainly valued. In America and in England, you had vaudeville. And in vaudeville, for the first time, you have really the real commercialization of comedy, of all sorts of comedy, almost all the forms that we have now. So this is a stand-up, it's a comedian from the 1880s. And of course, the routine is somewhat misogynistic, but it's not that alien to us. And have you noticed how ladies are taking part in politics lately? Well, we'll soon have a lady policeman. And I suppose if we have a lady policeman, we'll have lady pickpockets. Well, for that matter, we have lady pickpockets now. I know, I'm married. Okay, so this is the 1880s. So for the first time, you get people who are standing up on stage and essentially telling jokes. Now, they're not only telling jokes, they're getting paid for it. Okay, so comedy, through vaudeville, becomes commercial. All of the silent film stars are going to come out of vaudeville. Vaudeville, then radio, then television. So now what you have, and this is part of the history of humor itself, is the commercialization of humor. It's part of what I'm a part of. You also, right after the Civil War, you have the birth of all the college humor. So that's another interesting point in terms of after our greatest national tragedy is actually when you have the outgrowth of humor. So all of these magazines, Life was not what, you know, what later became Judge. I mean, so once again, so the New Yorker comes around in 1925. So you can see, the New Yorker originally is a humor magazine. It's not serious in any way. But when you go back and you look at the cartoons from 1925 in the New Yorker, I couldn't show you the terrible cartoons from the other magazines. They're pretty terrible. This is from 1925. They're long. This is who's the old boy going out? Remember, he's had tough luck. His wife ran away about a year ago, and then he lost the ball in the rough, and that's it. So they go on a long way. And they're often these dialogue cartoons. And this is based on sort of the tradition of what cartoons was. One of the things that New York did is, you know, they didn't invent the joke. It compressed the joke. Probably no one did that quicker and better than James Thurber Touché. So by 1931, you're getting this compression of an idea. You're getting this idea of an image that is immediately resolved, you know, in the caption. You get Peter Arno, now read me the part of the end where I disinherit everybody. And this, well, back to the old drawing board, the phrase, back to the drawing board, originates with this cartoon. Okay, how did humor change? 1947, here's a woman saying, for goodness sake, why didn't they tell us there'd be an extra name? Now, of course, that's based on stereotypes of women and not knowing sports. But the interesting thing is, the woman in the cartoon is not making the joke. In other words, she's not saying the line. Okay, here, by 2003, I started my vegetarianism for health reasons, then it became a moral choice, now it's just to annoy people. So every generation uses humor. humor based on the humor that they experience, okay? So the experience of this generation or our generation is sitcom, where people actually do say the joke. Okay, in terms of the cartoons that I picked for The New Yorker, they're all different types. So they're the cartoons that are based in reality. My boss is always telling me what to do. You know, that's like those are the idiotic complaints that we have, that this is reality. Then there are cartoons that their only purpose is a joke. Okay, very impressive, I'd like to find 5,000 more like you. Well, okay, if that isn't funny, there's no reason for it. It's not making other point, it's not making, it's in the world of fantasy. And then there are cartoons which are just basic. You know, the type of humor we like often depends on a lot of other personality characteristics. So there's humor that has this complete closure, and then there's humor that's sort of crazy, right? Okay, like, David Hopkins, did you get yesterday's memo? So you can't explain that joke in the same way that you can explain the other jokes. What I try to pick for the magazine is a wide range of humor, from satire to observational to gags to crazy. So I don't want to compare apples to oranges to kiwis. Okay, the interesting thing about The New Yorker, I'm not going to go through these cartoons, The New Yorker tracks the history from its start. These are cartoons that show all cartoons based on the stock market during the 20s and 30s. And I can show you each cartoon how it relates to what happened. Okay, here's a brief history of the internet and cartoons. 1993, Peter Simon, on the internet, nobody knows your dog. 1999, it's information. Look, there's no Google. Now there is 2002. I can't explain it, it's just a funny feeling around being Google. 2005, I had my own blog for a while, but I decided to go back to pointless incessant blog. 2009, Facebook. Why can't you use Facebook like everybody else? 2013, I believe that's one of Rembrandt's earliest songs. Well, because I started 2011. Says here, leaves behind a wife, two children, and 47 Twitter followers. 2014, Google Glass. Hey, you're the one who wanted a three. 2014, also, hold on, I'm going to conference in my wrist. And now, full circle, 2015. Remember when on the internet nobody knew who you were? So that's a wonderful thing about The New Yorker. It actually tracks. It's sort of a funhouse mirror of our own time. Okay, we also. So this is a partial list of The New Yorker's keywording list that was put into all those volumes going back to 1925. And of course, Patty is at the Organization of American Historians. Of course, we have history. And so we'll have cartoons on history. If you went up to the cartoon bank, which I found there, you put in history, you'd have like 650 cartoons. If you put in, you know, you have cartoons like this. The Athenians are here, sire, with an offer to back us with ships, money, arms, and men, and of course, the usual lectures. I like the concept that you can do it with no new facts. Okay, coaching a little giant. Okay, now, if he comes at you with a house divided against itself, cannot stand with two of them. Okay, if you search for Columbus, you get this. Your Majesty, my voyage will not only forge a new route to the spices of the East, but create over 3,000 new. Just tell me about the new continent, and I don't give a damn what you've discovered about yourself. Three ships is a lot of ships. Why can't you prove the world is round? We thought and thought, but we're at a loss about what to call ourselves. Okay, but what happens when history, real history, tragic history, bumps up against humor on 9/11? Okay, so 9/11, we were still at the Condé Nast building. Now we're actually at the New World Trade Center. That's where we are all the time. So 9/11, of course, close to 3,000 people had died, and where we can have cartoons in the magazine. Well, the first week we didn't have any cartoons in the magazine. That was the only time in 46 when John Hersey did Hiroshima, there was also no cartoons. No cartoons. But then we knew we were going to have to put, it's a week later, So eventually you're going to have to put cartoons back. How, what type of cartoon? So this was the first cartoon that we published after 9/11. I thought I'd never laugh again, then I saw your faces. And so this is very sweet humor, very benign. It's not directed out, you know what I mean? What happened, it's directed in to the reality of life and surviving. That you're going to, actually, if you're going to be alive, you are going to laugh. That although you remember after 9/11, people said everything has changed. Well, everything has changed except people. People don't change. I mean, one of the huge things is we know now in retrospect how little people changed. Everything was the same. This was a month later, or 2 months, we'll need to declaw the cat. You know, and while these seem like very sort of simple gags, I also think they have deep insight into the insanity of security theater. You know what I mean? Deep insight in that you actually could not get on planes after 9/11 with a small nail clipper. And just think about it. Okay, the terrorist has a nail clipper. He's got a nail clipper. And he's backing everybody. And he's showing you what can happen. How if you clip too tight, it can really hurt. So you couldn't bring a nail clipper on. So I think in a way this was prescient. While it says, but that's what was actually happening. Okay, and then it was all the self-justification. I figure if I only have that third martini, then the terrorists would. Then we did this a couple of years later. I didn't mind living in a tiny room. But, so, there was the original, so then, and then the question of what type of cartoons you get depending on difficult context. So certainly the original before Charlie Hebdo was there was a Danish cartoon controversy where, it's actually a complicated story because originally it comes about because there's a children's book which was supposed to just illustrate the life of Muhammad as a children's book. And there are death threats that if you do this. So in that case, no disrespect, but basically you're saying that even though you're not, you know, you're actually being completely respectful, if you do this, we will kill you. So I know Fleming Rose, who published the cartoon, and he's got a really interesting book called The Tyranny of Silence, which is about censorship and self-censorship. So those cartoons actually were very mild. I mean, really completely mild. The thing was the threat. And what in Timothy Garden Ash in the New York Review of Book called The Assassin's Veto, which is basically saying, we're going to kill you. And although people gave many reasons why they wouldn't show these cartoons again, the real reason was they were afraid of being killed. That's absolutely, you know, the reason. Now, the New Yorker, the cartoon that we published was, please enjoy this culturally, ethnically, religiously, and politically correct. So we were making fun of it in that way, but we also didn't want to be killed. Now, or the security involved, or the whole of actually what happens with essentially maniacs. Now, I gave a little talk in support of Charlie Hebdo. So people didn't actually know what Charlie Hebdo published. They didn't actually know the tradition of it. They didn't know that there was a very small portion of cartoons don't believe in Islam. But the idea that they were Islamophobic didn't make any sense because after all, they got killed by Islamic fanatics. So I gave a talk and at Penn, which is, supports freedom of speech supposedly, but many of the people at this gala at Penn had not supported the support of Charlie Hebdo for the Courage Report. And I gave a talk. And my joke, and originally I was told don't do any jokes. No way I'm going up there not doing jokes. I mean, these guys were jesters and jokers. How can I actually defend them? So what I said was, I know a lot of, it was a black eye affair. I said, I know a lot of people have backed out of this event, but I wasn't because I spent a lot of money on this tux. And the reason why is because it's bulletproof. So while the New Yorker is not the right place for for many things. I'll show you why, because it's a sense of the idea, for me, of freedom of speech. And one of the things that you have to remember about freedom of speech, I mean, originally, you know, Oliver Wendell Holmes talks about it, it's freedom. The whole point is freedom for speech we don't like. Freedom for speech we actually hate. And also, you have to remember that part of the message sometimes of speech is ridicule, is that I think your ideas are so ludicrous that I actually want to make fun of them. I don't think they deserve. Of course, I don't think they deserve argument. So that's part of the message. You can't eliminate that message. So what is the New Yorker? The New Yorker is a really serious magazine. So it's weird in a way that cartoons are even in there. When I first got into the New Yorker, my mother said, "So your cartoon illustrates the article." No. "So it has something to do with something else in the magazine." No. "So why did they put it there?" Which is sort of a good question. It's almost a happy accident that in this very serious magazine are these cartoons. And part of it is just to give actually the New Yorker, in some metaphorical sense, a sense of humor. Because a sense of humor means that it's broader than seriousness. But still, because the magazine is so, empathy is often the opposite of humor, when we really care so much about things. So one way to look at humor is, you know, the stuff I showed you has a little bit of danger, right? It's a little bit bad. There's always something a little bit making fun of, a little bit transgressive. The Viagra thing, okay, should you be laughing at that? Or let's say I showed you this cartoon. There's a gallows, and there's normal steps going up, but there's also a ramp for the handicap. Okay, so now you could say, "Oh, I'm sure I laughed at that. But what does that mean? Am I a bad person?" So you were, it's like, so this zoo, is like, this is danger, right? Okay, the tiger's there. So in a way, humor protects us a little bit from feeling bad about having bad feelings. So it's a little bit like the bars here. Now, we could be completely protected going to a zoo, right? We could just take the tiger out, and that would be bad. But also in a magazine like ours, that's bad too. So we have to sort of balance things, right? Now look at this. Okay, so you're laughing at that. But here's how easy it is for the tiger to jump out of the cage into the New Yorker. Email comment on this cartoon, another joke on all white males, haha, the wit. It's nice, I'm sure, to be young and rude, but someday you'll be old unless you drop dead, as I wish. Cordially, Robin. Okay, it's discouraging dad on the antidepressants. Okay, so here's an online survey of that. That I did, and so most people did like it. They rated it a 10, you know, most people that. This person didn't. I only rated 3. I like animals. 1, 2, 3. That person likes animals. 5 exclamation points. 6 exclamation points is unhelpful. I don't like to see animal stuff, even in cartoons. And I tell these people they don't suffer. They can't suffer. They don't suffer. We use anesthetic ink. But this is very revealing. This is actually the real distribution of people's responses to any cartoon. The humor you like best, the joke you think is the world's greatest joke, somebody else doesn't. Okay? In here, we tend to have a consensus because laughter, the contagion of laughter, creates the consensus. But this is the real response when you don't have an audience. There's a distribution. That cartoon is going to be funny for a lot of people, but for some people it's not. And for those people for whom it's not funny, they're not wrong. You know, you can't be wrong about what you, in terms of your response. Like, it'd be like you said, me saying to you,
how do you like that slice of pizza? And you say, I love it, and then I say to you, no, you don't.
Doesn't make any sense. Okay, look at this. I've only been gluten-free for a week, but I'm already in the market. Email header. Shame on you, for those of us with celiac disease, I find it very insane. Living GF for us is necessity for life, and not a fair that we live is okay. Try walking around in our shoes. Now, with a person like that, it makes sense, because if you walk around in your shoes, you'll be a mile away from them. And you will have their shoes. You can't beat that. You know. Okay, now sometimes people don't like the cartoons because they don't get them. And there's a famous Seinfeld episode from 98, written by none other than Bruce Eric Kaplan, who's a cartoonist for The New Yorker. And when Bruce wrote it, and I found out about it, I called Bruce and I said, et tu, Bruce? Okay, let's listen to it.
This cartoon in The New Yorker. I don't get this.
Me neither.
And you're on the fringe of the humor business. Hey, George, look at this.
That's cute.
You get it?
No, never mind.
Come on, we're two intelligent people here. We can figure this out.
It looks like my accountant's office. There's no pets working there.
I've enjoyed reading your email.
It's got something to do with that 42 in the corner.
It's a page number.
I can't crack this one.
Well, you know, one thing to remember is sometimes you can't crack it, but sometimes the very best caption for a cartoon is the simplest. Sort of makes you stop and think. I made you stop and think a little bit about cartoons. Thanks very much. I'm happy to be here. Wait in the back. Talk loud.
Okay, so you get like a two from a person who doesn't like seeing animals be hurt in cartoons. Like, what do you think makes them give a two instead of a one?
They're a hypocrite. They know they're really a one, but they say they're a two. But the interesting thing, it goes back actually rating these types of things, one of the things I'm doing now in the caption contest, your question goes, what's the best way actually to have people make judgments? And rating actually is a weird thing for people, because and not just for cartoons. Like if you were rate, hey, how nice is my hair? Even a four or five, all of a sudden you're making sort of crazy decisions with numbers, okay? So I think it basically meant, it might have meant actually that they thought in some way it was a little funny, rather zero funny. But that's my best answer. Yeah, another question? Yeah, right here.
Really stupid one. My first acquaintance with The New Yorker was when I was about 10 years old in my dentist's office.
Yeah.
Distracting myself by reading through and discovering the wealth of cartoons.
Yeah.
What's the record for the number of cartoons in a single issue, and has that number changed over the years?
The record for a single number of cartoons, this is like great. Welcome to Cartoon Trivia. Sports fans, well, you know, I don't think this record will ever be broken, Dave. I mean, that was set back in 1947, completely different situation. The quality of the paper and everything is different. You could fit hundreds of cartoons in then now, and the paper quality. You can't compare today's cartoons in the magazine to the players now. You have the steroids going on in the paper and everything. It's totally impossible. But my guess would be... There are less cartoons in the magazine because there are fewer pages. So if you look at the New Yorker, probably the most cartoons that would ever exist probably during the height of the New Yorker's dominance as a advertising medium for upper scale, not just New Yorkers, but in the nation. So you go back, if you look at issues from 64 and 65, there might be 240 issues. So it's chock full of advertising. So you can't put cartoons that are on pages. Right now, we average about 16 or 17. So if you would have looked back, let's say, to other years, you would see the New Yorker would have published maybe 1,100 or 1,200 cartoons in a year. Now it's about 850. Overall time, we published, you know, close to 80,000. Yeah, another question? Yeah.
Yeah, can you talk about Charles Adams and surrealism and maybe how he's evolved?
Yeah, well, of course, Charles Adams is probably the most famous New Yorker cartoonist. Interestingly, the Adams family in which the films came about did not come about that many cartoons. In most of his cartoons, he had about 1,100 cartoons. There might be 20 and 30 that had the Addams Family. And once the Addams Family became a TV show, the New Yorker would not print any more Addams Family cartoons. So, but generally, what Adams did, and this is interesting in the broader part of the culture, is he made macabre funny. He made gothic funny. So if you look at horror films from the 20s and 30s, they're all horror, right? But if you look at horror films now, they're always funny too, right? They always have to have some, Friday the 13th and Freddy's making jokes. So he was a wonderful cartoonist. I met him, he died in 86, and so I met him, you know, briefly and whatever. By the New Yorker cartoons in the 30s and 40s, sometimes the artist wouldn't actually be doing the idea. They'd be collaborations. So Peter Arnold did very few of his ideas. Jim Garrity, who was the art editor and cartoon editor at the time, supplied ideas. Charles Adams did pretty much all of his ideas, but by the 80s, he was being supplied with ideas. With you would come in, new cartoons would come in, and they would often buy ideas for Charles Adams. And so it's sort of interesting because, once he created his genre, you could write for that genre, just like you can write for a sitcom. That's just like Seinfeld, whereas Larry David and Seinfeld originally created Seinfeld. In the end, they're not writing the episodes; you're writing for it. So, I think he has an enormous influence. He's probably one of the few cartoonists, more than any other, whose cartoons would still sort of be funny pretty much to anyone. Yeah, over there.
How about Gay and Wilson?
Gay and Wilson. We publish Gay and Wilson, but we don't really publish X. The real Gay and Wilson, that comes out from Playboy, really. So Gay and Wilson is essentially an heir to Charles Adams, but more rococo, you know what I mean? More weird, the monster, the stranger. I mean, generally, I wonder how many times I go walking. What do you think the record is, Dave, for not walking? Thousands of presentations, and I would just figure that every once in a while I would just fake it. but he is the heir to it, and it's interesting. See, in Gay Hand, Charles Adams is a good artist or an absolutely competent draftsperson, okay? But you don't look at his stuff for the draftsmanship. You look at Gay Hand Wilson's cartoon for the monster. You know what I mean? The monster is going to be, and so also when I look at cartoons, sometimes it's a package deal. You know what I mean? Sometimes, you know, you're going to buy a George Booth cartoon because you just love the way the dogs look. You know what I mean? So there's many, many, many decisions like that. You have other questions? Okay, right here.
So Bob, the internet, you know, we're reading books on the internet, yeah. and we get funny stuff on the internet, not so funny stuff. How is that affecting the cartoon business?
Well, I sold the cartoon bank to Condé Nast, so it affected my cartoon business pretty well because we do license it. We do license the cartoons, so the cartoonists, so it helps the cartoons in that way, certainly. The difficulty, I think, in a lot of creative fields, and this is true of cartooning now, is that so much is available for free. Okay, and that a lot of wonderful stuff is being done for free, okay, really creative stuff done for free, and the question is, can you, like my parents would have asked, can you make a living at this? You know, can it be can it be a vocation rather than an avocation? And I think that's really up in the air. There's always going to be a small number of people who can make their way doing cartooning and doing art. But the internet presents a challenge because of this. Another way to look at it is that, well, maybe that's good. Maybe it's great that more people, that the less people have it as a profession and more people have it as an avocation. That the end result is what really gets out there in the world. You know, so I think it's a two-edged, double-edged sword like that. Yeah, back right there.
Comment about the cartoon caption contest?
The cartoon caption contest is the monster I created. Back in 1998, when it was just once a year at the cartoon issue. Now it occurs every week, and I have a whole talk on that. And there are three images that come on the back page of every New Yorker. There's a contest you can enter, and it's an incongruous image. So it's an image like it's got to be something normal about it and something anomalous. So it's a boardroom, that's normal. They're all guys at the table, that's normal. They all have parrots on their shoulder, that's not it. You have to resolve the incongruity, right? You have to make sense of it. So that's one, and then you'll see then three finalists that you have to vote on, and then the winner. The whole course of it is about 5 weeks. The way it works is we get between, on an average, 5,000 captions every week. I wrote some computer programs, my assistant, Colin Stokes, downloads them all. I have an assistant, they usually last about 2 years before they become brain dead. He goes through all of them, and as he's going, he has a little program, yes, no, maybe, and he's also sort of categorizing, because although there are 5,000 captions, they're not 5,000 different ones. Often categories, many identical captions. So I'm also working with Microsoft and computer linguists. They have automatic algorithms that at least cluster, show what the captions are. And also maybe crowds. Anyway, the 5,000 come in. I get about 60 or 70 broken down into different categories. From those, I pick 8. I upload them to SurveyMonkey. I send them out to the cartoon editors in the New Yorker. I get back the results, and then I pick the one I want. Sort of like that, but it's a fascinating. I've kept a database of all 2.5 million entries, so I know everybody's entered, how many times they've entered, and this is like some of the research I'm doing with Microsoft and computer linguists, because it's really the largest sort of crowd-based, user-generated source of humor we have that is also categorized in a useful way, so that you can look at it. You can look at differences between men and women's humor, even though we don't ask for the data on how old you are. You can easily extrapolate the data just from people's first names or make pretty good assessments. So it's actually pretty interesting.
So do you have entrants that have won multiple times because they're so damn witty on the contest?
Larry Woods from Chicago has won 6 times. And we have like special issues. We have a special cartoon issue which will be out in November. And I'm friends with Larry. And he's written a like little essay on having the caption contest. And also every week, part of my research, I have Larry send me in, what I asked him to do is sort of a diary of the thought process. And it's really quite interesting to show how someone who's very adept at this actually goes about it sort of methodically in creating associations and looking at various alternatives and generating lots of stuff. Yeah?
And who's the most persistent loser?
What?
Who's the most persistent loser?
Gee, what's his name? I forget. he's a great guy, and they're not that bad, but he's entered like 450 some contests. And I wrote a blog called, his name is Dominic, you know, Dauntless Dominic was the name of the blog, it's hard to win the contest. Because your actually entries can be pretty good and you'll still lose. Well, I think we're going to conclude for now. I really appreciate everybody coming and enter the contest.
Okay, I'll send another set.